Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Catherine Garforth from Garforth Education, and this is the Right to Read Initiative, a place where educators get together and talk about best practices for teaching reading. Today, I am very excited to have Judy Boxner from New York for a second time. Last week, we learned about her journey to the science of reading, and today we're going to learn about the tips and tricks she loves using in her classroom. Judy has a number of different trainings behind her, so we're going to see that real multi-step, multi-method approach to teaching reading. Thank you for joining me today, Judy. How are you?
I am super excited. I want to thank all the people that are listening and watching today. As you all know, I do podcasts and shows on the Literacy View with Faith Borkowski and Mary. And I also work for the New York City Public School System. And as you all know, I've had an extensive amount of training, beginning with reading recovery, which had many, many great things. I know that there's a lot of viewers out there that might be like, oh no, but there was a lot of great learning, but there were also many shifts that I've made in my journey. And now I am taking best practices, and now I've been trained in Orton-Gillingham Foundations, which is my passion, letters training as well. So, you know, my journey has been very interesting, and the learning is continuous. And, you know, I reflect on things that are working well, look at the science, listen to what people are saying, what my students are showing me in those classrooms, and refining my practices on a daily basis.
As teachers and educators, we have to be committed to being lifelong learners. And it's gone are the days when you just had like a one schoolhouse or one room schoolhouse classroom and taught the same curriculum and didn't have to worry about new endeavors. But now we really have to be on the edge of our seats waiting for that next best practice so that we can really get to that 95% rate of readers in the first few grades.
Absolutely.
So what are your favorite grades? Because right now you're more as a support role as opposed to being a classroom teacher. You're supporting the teachers. So What are your favorite tips across the grades?
So basically, as a classroom teacher, my favorite grades to teach were always kindergarten, first grade, second grade, and pre-K. Mm-hmm. Because those are the foundational years that I felt were so imperative to make sure that those kids had the building blocks to become successful lifelong readers. Mm-hmm. Now, meeting students, you know, there's been many students that have come my way and have had struggles as well. Different barriers, you know, some programs were working for them, some programs were not. Some of my students were ENL students that needed more support with vocabulary and so forth. They couldn't just, you know, decode words through meaning because that word was possibly not meaningful for them. So, you know, there's been many practices that I reflect on that I had to actually change. One of them being looking at pictures. For many years, I was the teacher that was trained in balanced literacy. I was very, very happy with that training because it did have many great things. And I think that some people, when they hear the word balanced literacy, think that that means that, you know, it was only like a whole language approach. And that wasn't the case always in my experience. Balanced literacy meant, you know, there was phonics, but there was also, you know, shared reading and different modalities and so forth. But one of the songs that I was guilty of singing to my students, I made it up. Pictures and words are good friends, are good friends. They help you when you're reading. They help you when you're reading till the end. And I literally want to take that song and never sing it again. I want to rip it up into pieces because that practice I did find, and the research does find, is not most supportive in helping our learners. And, you know, recently I was even working with some private clients and I had a student and I could tell what the classroom instruction was. It was basically telling the student to look at the picture as their first, you know, point of action. And the head literally could not move away from that picture. So now in my practice, I have 99% of the time, actually 100% of the time, and I know one of my teachers is here viewing right now, knows that one of the first courses of action that I recommend to all literacy teachers, experts, and everyone out there is first course of action is looking at that visual print and having students slide through the word and applying those skills that they know. And I'll get more into that after, and I'll show what that looks like with the book and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Well, another practice that I've seen is teachers actually using post-it notes to cover the words. And then as they're reading the text, well, let's think about what word would make sense here.
Yeah.
Good readers use this strategy all the time.
Yeah.
Well, I was speaking with Janelle Keller from California, who's a high school teacher, looking at these students in freshman year, so in grade 9, and what a reading approach using that strategy looks like in high school, where they can read maybe 5% of the text on the page, and they're like, yeah, I read it. I skipped the words I didn't know, looked at pictures, that didn't help. I guessed the ones that I could based on context.
Right.
I don't know what it's saying.
Right. So no more covering of those things. The words are there for a reason. We have to train our readers that English is not as tricky as we all perceive it to be. And yes, first course of action should be looking at that word, sliding through it at points of difficulty. And maybe it won't be a point of difficulty if we don't create that tension around words. You know, English is not as tricky as we perceive it to be. Right? You probably know the statistics better than I do, Dr. Garforth. What are the statistics of how many words are actually tricky in English and so forth? I think it's, I don't want to be on record saying the wrong amount, but.
Yeah, I'm not good
with it. We'll get back. We'll
post it. 20% or less.
Right, exactly.
And the vast majority of the word is phonetic.
Exactly. Right?
Just those few letters that make it so it's wrong, at least in the English language. And I think we do a huge disservice to our young students telling them that it's so complicated. I mean, it's that same fallacy that we, say that, well, girls can't do math.
Right.
Well, actually, English isn't that complicated.
Right.
If you understand how it works, and guess what?
Right.
I'm going to teach you. So in the beginning, it's going to be a little bit tricky because you don't know everything. But once we get you closer to knowing all the rules, it's actually pretty easy.
Right. And I think that's like a good starting point for what I was actually thinking. So, I've been in education now for 24 years. I'm only in my 40s, everybody. But yes, I've been in education for 24 years. And, I wish, what are those books? Like What to Expect When You're Expecting or something?
Yeah.
Like a book like What I Wish I Would Have Known When I Started Out. Like, I wish somebody would have said, Judy, these are the syllable types, and this is how they can help kids read. And, I read so many books where I had to, really figure it out. I give total kudos to Wiley Blevins, who was working with the Universal Literacy Team so much. There it was in 2 pages. He made it simple, clear, easy, the syllable types. Foundation says there's 6. Or in Gillingham says there's 7, it's fine. But I think that every teacher needs to know their syllable types, because if we're going to teach our kids how to decode, let's start with that. And I promise myself that next school year, the first PD that I ask a principal to do is on the syllable types. If I'm doing a literacy PD, how about we start there? And it's funny, it's like I sit there as a literacy coach. Oh, do they have time? No, I have to insist, this is an emergency. We have a literacy crisis in our country, and I'm sure you might have similar. So I don't know if you want me to show anything to our viewers today. I have a little magic marker. And
yes, please do. I mean, I love syllable types. It's what, as a dyslexic myself, it's what really made the difference, because I was learning to read in, grade 6 and grade 7. And I didn't want to read the baby books.
Right.
And understanding those syllable types gave me a starting point. And yes, they did work on the CVC stuff at the beginning as they built the grapheme phoneme correspondences. But then having that strategy for attacking bigger words and saying, oh, that's a consonant LE or a vowel T, and knowing what to do with it.
Right, exactly. And that, you know, and it's also not fearing using more sophisticated language with kids. Like, you don't have to just show them the tongue movement. You could also say, you know what? SH says, shh, let's say it together. That's a diagram. Guess what? Little kids, kindergarteners can relate to that and they can understand it very quickly. So we have to respect our learners, believe in our learners, and be exclusive with those learners. And I know that there'll be some people watching today that say, you know, syllable types are not necessary. And I'm, you know, debating with some other literacy experts and learning from them as well. There are other ways. I heard there's another approach called vowel flexing. Mm-hmm. But for me, my data is showing right now, syllable type work and marking up words is working for my students. And if it's not, I'm going to look for different options for that learner to make sure that it's meeting their specific needs. That's who I am as a literacy specialist. I'm not a my way or the highway kind of person. So here we have simple. Can you see my board?
Yeah.
All right. Numero uno, number one. Here we have the word. What's the word? Is it backwards when you see it?
Yeah.
Oh no. What do I do to not make it backwards?
Oh no, sorry. It's not backwards.
Oh, it's not. Okay. No. So the word is cat. So I'm going to scoop it. That's what we do in foundations. We scoop it. And underneath we're writing it's closed because it's closed by a consonant. And we even tell our students, because we want them to know what vowels do. Like a vowel's there for a reason. It's either going to be short, long, or do something, you know, a vowel team, but that's a whole different story. And it gets a little breve because it's short. And then you could prompt kids with questions. You could push the thinking a little deeper. What sound does that A make? What sound does that make?
Ah.
What's the word? Cat. Right. So that's the closed syllable type. Do you want me to go through the rest?
Yeah.
Do we have time? All right. Yeah. So then we have number two, the open syllable type. And what a shame, though, that I didn't know this until joining the Universal Literacy Team 6 years ago. I knew it, but not in the sense that I know it now. So here's the word hi, right? It's not closed in by a consonant. You scoop it because you're scooping the syllable. And for multisyllabic words, obviously you'll have more syllables. And underneath, you're not writing closed, you're writing an O for open. And your vowel is not going to get a breve this time. It's going to get a macron. What sound is your vowel making? I. What does the word say? Hi. All right. So that's number two, open syllable type.
Well, and when I was taught these, we even had hand signals, right?
Well, tell me about that.
Closed.
Oh, yes.
Vowel team, consonant LE, R controlled.
Oh, why is that R controlled?
Because your thumb's getting your ring finger.
Tell me more about that.
Because just to signal the R's controlling, the ring's controlling the vowel.
Oh, we'll have to talk more off camera about that. I'm going to ask you more questions later. I could talk about that for an hour, but I don't know if everybody in America or in Canada wants to hear me talking about that for a long time.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I can't remember, but it was open, closed, vowel team, consonant LE, and the robber R.
And what program was that with? Was that with the program?
I went to a school called Kenneth Gordon School. And it was a school that was specifically for students with learning disabilities. And their program was based on Orton Gillingham.
Right.
This school, they wrote their own handbooks. It was a 5-handbook Orton Gillingham system. And they've actually, you know, the founders of this school has created a lot of the Orton Gillingham original resources from the 90s. Like if you know those spiral bound prefix suffix root books.
I think I might have some of that stuff.
It's like green, black, and red. Those teachers wrote that. So this.
I've seen also open and closed syllable types shown in my Orton Gillingham training. They showed us like a door that's open for open syllable types. I'm still exploring that a little bit more.
I like the hand signals because you can do them to your students and they can, you know, you can kind of signal to them if they're getting stuck. But that's just my personal.
If you could ever like do a little clip of it so that I can have it on your video archive to review it, that would be super cool. So then quickly, I don't know if your viewers want me to go into all of them. I could like post them after or take a picture of them. Number three, we have the silent E. So a word like. And silent E, I'm going to be honest. I think that in many programs, it comes up too late.
Mm-hmm.
Even in foundations. So good teaching, like a program is a program. And yes, you have to follow with fidelity, but you also have to follow your kids and their needs. And when you're seeing them in small group instruction, their needs might be ahead of what the class is doing or different than what the class is doing. So don't be afraid to teach things that are, you know, in small group instruction that is customized to the needs and more student-centered for your students. So we have the silent E.
Oh, that was the
scoop.
That was the silent E.
Yeah, and then it gets a B because it has a vowel.
Yeah. C.
A dash and an E.
Yeah.
And then you cross out the E because he's silent. And your I can get a macron again. And then quickly, number four. And you know what, guys? Some people might be like, this is not fun and it's not interesting, but this is what I, as a 24-year educator, wish that I would have known way earlier. And I hope that I motivate people to not ignore it, to learn it, to embrace it, because it could really change your own life, but also the life of the readers in front of you. Mm-hmm. And I get teary-eyed because there's guilt of what I could have known before, because I helped a lot of kids. Listen, a lot of the students that I worked with, they God bless, they graduated college and high school. But there were some kids that didn't break the reading code and did continue to struggle. And you know what? That is why I'm fully committed to knowing I can do better. And I could also reflect and say, you know what? I wasn't perfect. I need to learn more. And I hope that all these people, the science of reading people, the reading recovery people, the balanced literacy people, just stop fighting and say, let's just focus on best practices and let's do better for our kids. Because it really makes me upset. And that's why I kind of started the literacy view, because I got so sick of the separatist approach to literacy. And it's not about, you know, what's in a manual. It's about reflecting and learning and being open-minded and saying, you know what? I'm going to do better for my kids. And you know what? It goes further than just a manual. A manual could say something and then you're with your kids and you see you have to tweak it. And that's okay too. So it doesn't say, oh, the science is the science and it's a perfect science, because science is not perfect. And science evolves and we learn and get better. And that's what I'm doing every day.
I mean, that's why I created the Right to Read Initiative. It's not the Science of Reading Initiative. It's not Structured Literacy Initiative. It's the Right to Read, because, you know, yes, it's important for teachers to have different strategies that are based on research for teaching their students how to read. And we want to take those strategies and know how to apply them, because not every dyslexic is the same. The strategies that work for one are not going to work for another one. So you're going to have to reach into that bag of tricks.
That's it.
And just make sure that the tricks that you have in your bag aren't looking at pictures or guessing based on context or just skipping the word because it's not a
right. And you know what? I'm not going to say that meaning is not important, because like meaning is super, super important. And it is the ultimate goal of reading. And I think sometimes people forget that or don't talk enough about it. It is a big part. And for some kids, meaning will help them. It will. But for some kids, it won't. Mm-hmm. So we have to be prepared to help all our readers so that they can integrate all those neurons to work seamlessly to decode and to understand, because that is the ultimate goal, you know, because we don't want a generation of kids that can only decode and not know what's on the page too. That is a critical piece. And my hope, as you know, New York City's shifting faster than the speed of lightning. They're shifting towards dyslexia awareness and a much more phonics-centered approach. And I embrace it and I am excited. But my only, not caution, but my only thing that I want everybody to remember, including myself, is that literacy has five pillars of instruction plus writing. There's phonemic awareness, there's phonics, there's vocabulary, there's comprehension, and there's fluency, phrasing and fluency. And all those pieces need attention. We can't just pay attention to one pillar. We can't. So I guess the word balanced literacy is out, but we do kind of need a balance of, you know, making sure the foundational skills in general are attended to. So here's number four. Back to number four. We have, here's the word STEAM. And this is a really important one. It is your vowel team. So we circle it in foundations, we scoop it, and we write a D on the bottom. It took me a while. I'm like, why a D? Double vowel, double vowel. And we know, and this is where you can have those meaty discussions with your kids after phonics time and small group reading time and strategy groups on what happens. What sound is that making? E. Right. And that's where the first, back in the 80s, we were saying it.
When two
vowels go walking, the first one does the talking. And it's fun. I'm having those discussions with kids again. And it's been a while since, you know, people had those discussions and I'm starting to hear it again. And then we have number five is our R control. Yeah. And what was your symbol for that again, Dr. Garforth? Yep. There's my R control. I'm circling it. And I'm putting an R for R control. All right. And then number six, I'm not going to do the Oring Gillingham 7 today. If anybody wants to reach out to me, we could talk about that off camera. Find me on the literacy view. And number six is, this is a multi-syllabic word with more than one syllable. The first syllable is an R control, but we're looking at the second syllable. So the word is marble, and I'm scooping the second syllable. That's the consonant L-E. So if you know how to decode that, like marble, table, cable, it doesn't become a mystery. It's not going to be as hard as it should for the kids. So there's a crash course. If anybody wants to reach out to me, if anybody wants to talk to me, email me, whatever you guys need, I will definitely reach out. Reach out to Dr. Garforth, message her, message me, and I would love to connect. So that was one piece. That was number one. I have like a million more. I don't know how much time we have.
Keep going.
All right. So the other one that is a really good one for me is Elkhonon boxes. I am obsessed with Elkhonon boxes. And guess where my journey with Elkhonon boxes began? Dun, dun, dun.
Reading recovery.
Yeah. So I have to give great kudos to my reading recovery team, Jay Montgomery, Liz Sassone in New York City. And they taught me about Elkhonon boxes. Now, I don't have like the great chips and everything because I'm at home. It's been a long day. So if the word is cat, can you see it?
Yeah.
My chips are flying. Huh. You could start with chips. And then the last tip, the chip is right there. This is not magnetic. I thought it was magnetic. Right? So you start with chips. That's the first stage. Why? Because we're training the phonemic awareness skills, right? What sound do you hear? Kuh. What sound do you hear in the middle? Ah. What sound do you hear at the end? And of course, you could play with your kids. You could ask them which sound they hear and where. They could play with their first sound if you're working on last sounds. So you want to teach your kids to hear all sounds. Of course, you're going to start in the regular order, but then you got to, you know, really enhance that rigor. But it didn't stop there. And also, Dr. Garforth, I could share with you a document that I worked on with a colleague of mine at the New York City Department of Education, where we took what we learned and we actually put it in a one-page article or like, we were doing a presentation in New York City. We had something called the Share Fair, where we presented on the different stages of the Elkhonon boxes, because the truth is a lot of teachers stay in the Elkhonon stage for too long. So it starts with the chips. Then the next stage is where it goes from k, ah, t, you transfer it to the writing. So you, this is where the phonics piece comes in. And that's good because you don't want it to stay in the phonemic stage for too long, right? Learning is a progression. So when your kids are ready, you move it. So now you have phonics. But then this is the really forgotten stage. And I have to say that I'm really blessed that Reading Recovery started my journey in this learning, but structured literacy is where I got even better at it, is something called spelling boxes. So the spelling boxes were really where a child got to apply their phonic skills and take it to the next level. So say the word was steam, right? So the word is steam, and I'm not gonna make a box for, I'm gonna make a box for every letter. So in an Elkonin box, right? Let me go take it a step back. So in an Elkonin box, each letter gets a box, right? So
each
phoneme gets a box, right? But like if it was a word like ship, the SH would have shared, the digraph would have shared a box because it makes one sound. So for a spelling box, say the word is, let me see my word. Okay. Okay. So my word is steam. Okay. Now the procedure changed for this. We no longer pushed inside. We did more of a slide. So can I pretend that you're my kiddo?
Sure.
You don't mind?
Nope.
All right, Doc. All right. So say steam.
Steam.
Okay. Say it again.
Steam.
Okay. So what do you hear in the first box? Steam.
S.
Okay, say the word again.
Steam.
What do you hear in the next box? Okay. Steam. What do you hear in the next box?
E.
That's great. Now, in the next box, you don't hear anything, but there's a vowel team that you learned about in phonics or foundations or in your program. You know what vowel team would go with it? You don't hear it. You may or may not know.
E-E?
It could be. You're very right. But in this case, it's E-A. And it says E. All right? Your other choice was a very good choice, but it wasn't the right choice for this one. But thank you for that. You know a lot about vowel teams. What do you hear in the last box?
M.
And some people would say, no, the spelling box should still keep the EA together. I've spoken to some science of reading people who don't agree. But I think the key is that you're trying to take it to the next level to make sure that your kids start making those connections of what they're seeing in phonics and being able to apply those skills a little bit deeper. Mm-hmm. I think this is a game changer. Don't stay in your Elkonin boxes forever. We want our readers to progress. Elkonin boxes are great for that phonemic awareness. They're great but once a child knows most of their consonants, move into a spelling box and don't move back.
Thought I'd share a quote that I think is really pertinent to this right now. And it's from the National Reading Panel. So it's from, 2000. It says, it's important to note that acquiring phonemic awareness is a means rather than an end. Phonemic awareness is not acquired for its own sake, but rather for its value in helping children understand and use the alphabetic system to read and write. This is why including letters in the process of teaching children to manipulate phonemes is important. Phonological awareness training with letters helps learners determine how phonemes match up to graphemes within words and thus facilitates transfer to reading and spelling.
Absolutely. And I think that research is finding that more and more, even with programs like Hegarty. Mm-hmm. Here's my Hegarty guide. This is a printout. A lot of teachers were spending so much time saying, okay, this is a scripted program. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to where the research is finding not all of those skills are actually high leverage skills for what's necessary to have a really independent reader. So we were spending possibly too much time with maybe the syllable, hearing syllables, when we would maybe better spend our time with phoneme segmentation skills, initial sound fluency skills, and so forth. So I think, just as a side note, I have it in email today. I haven't looked at it yet, and I'll forward it to you, Dr. Garforth, and then you can do whatever you want with it. They actually listened to the research, and they acknowledged that the research is showing that there's certain skills that are much more not important, but are more high leverage than others. And they've made shifts, and they actually republished, and I have a little abridged version of what modifications they made. So I'm excited to explore that, and maybe you and I can talk about that at some point.
Sure. I'd love to.
Yeah.
So what's your next trip?
All right. Next trip. So next trip is super simple, but I think it's really important. So years ago, when I was trained in, yes, reading recovery, my prompting, there was a lot of talk about prompting. And I know that many people say you don't need prompting if the first prompt is always going to be looking at visual print. However, the prompting that I used in the past, I feel could have been refined, and it has been refined for me. And it's something that I'm extremely passionate about. So when a kid is reading, in the olden days, not the olden days, it's not like I'm from the 1800s or anything, but back in the day, we had teachers saying, do you see a part that you know? Do you see a part that can help you? Now, that's not really that helpful, because guess what? The kid might have no idea what you're talking about. However, the key of what we need to do as a team is help those kids make those connections of what they're seeing in phonics instruction actually happens in real books. Kids don't always get that connection, and the transference is not happening as much as it should. Mm-hmm. So here's an example. All right. And some people I know watching will be like, why didn't she pick a decodable? Because I did it. I use a lot of decodables. Sometimes I do. Sometimes I have different things going on. Okay. So here's, you see the book? Can you see the text?
Yeah.
All right. So here I am. I'm going to pretend to be a kiddo, and I'm stuck. All right. It says, cat will not, and here's a cat. And now, as a teacher, the kid said cat and has no idea what to say next. Make the sound of the digraph. Try. Cat. Shh. Catch. Cat will not catch me, said Mouse. And then as a teacher, I could say, I really like the way you made the sound of that digraph, that CH, to reinforce and make the brain want to do it again. The brain likes positive reinforcement. Big tip, do not tell kids they did a good job. That doesn't tell them a lot at all. Be very specific in your praising. I really like the way you slid your finger through that word and noticed that there was a digraph in it. We have to be specific with our praising. We cannot just say good job or don't do that. You have to be explicit. It's very important, because it's almost like, what is it? Like positive reinforcement. The brain wants to do something well again. And when you're being specific in what somebody did well, they're more likely to do it again. So I think that specific prompting is really important. I'm going to give one more example of that.
Well, and before you do that, I think it's important that you do give that, because it can also confirm that the student did do what you thought they did.
Exactly.
Well, they might say, well, actually, teacher, that's not what I did.
Right.
Exactly. And that gives you the opportunity to correct and say, Right. Wow, you know, you figured out the word, but can you tell me how you did that? So you can Understand their thought process and realize where you might have to step in to help them improve for next time.
And I think that's the most important thing that teachers could do. Like, even if you're not well-trained in small group reading or skills-based reading, listen to those kids read. Listen to them, give them a chance and start providing them with feedback. That's a start. Even if, like, tomorrow you're sitting down with a group and you're just petrified to, like, sit down with a group because you don't know the format of the lesson and you don't know what to do, give yourself some grace and start by listening to those kids And that's where a lot of your learning will also take place. You know, I think teachers are often, and myself included, are such perfectionists that we fear doing something wrong, or we're afraid because the school's not giving us enough help. And very often, guess what? People aren't getting enough help. And teachers are very often, they have 24 kids in their class or 25 kids with different needs, and you just don't know where to begin. And sometimes you're like fearful. Don't be afraid. Just listen to them read. Just listen.
Well, and there's always going to be another book to read or another paper or another product to buy. You'll spend your time stuck in the, oh, what's that Dr. Seuss book? Oh, the places you'll go. Stuck in wherever, just waiting. Time to pass. And you need to take action forward, because it's going to help you understand what you actually do know and where you need to look further.
Exactly. And then sometimes call in a friend or a colleague and like just ask for help. Be with a friend, support each other, play together, enjoy. Because I think that's what, you know, that was the best part of my experience as a classroom teacher. I wasn't that worried. It was just a safe space. I think now teaching has become so hard, and teacher evaluations and like being rated to how, you know, student progress, it's very stressful. And I think the key thing we have to remember is we're there to just love, support, and take those risks. And if you have a good administration, they're going to just be proud of you for just trying and like being reflective and saying, you know, I could do better. You know, you don't have to be perfect. And that's, you know, that's how I got through that many years, because, you know, I give myself grace because I'm far from perfect. I never had the fanciest classroom, but I was always very attentive to the kids, very loving. And I always set the bar really high where I believed that all my kids were capable. Like, I'm not going to give up. I'm going to do whatever it has, you know, whether I have to bring a Barbie to school because this kid loves Barbies and wants to write about Barbies, or, you know, I'm going to just be creative or use stickers to motivate or, you know, different things like that. So back to that thing, sliding through words. So no. I am too little to rid with you. So the kid said rid. And I could say, you know how the word works when there's a silent E. Try that again. Maybe try the vowel the other way. Mm-hmm. No. I am too little to ride with you. Oh, I really liked the way you noticed that there was a silent E and you knew what to do with that vowel. The first time you said E, but then you changed it to I. And instead of saying rid, you said ride. So that specific prompting of using that same language that you're using in phonics, game changer, game changer. I wish that I would have never said, do you see a part that you know? No. Let's be specific. That's one of my next buddies.
And that's where the other, whether you're talking about syllables or talking about vowel flexing, as some people call it sparring, you're trying to think of the different sounds that letter can make and see which one fits with the word.
Yeah, that's interesting. So I think I mentioned it in the last episode. My colleague and friend on the Literacy View, Faith Brokowski, she is very, very interested, or she knows a lot about that vowel flexing. And I did put it on my summer to-do list to look into that a little bit more. But my concern is, what if it's a triple syllabic word and you're flexing so many vowels? What happens then? So that's going to be my learning journey. You might know more about that, Dr. Garforth, than me, but that is something that I thought about. That's a lot of brain cognition that's going on. So for me, I'm still with the syllable types and just knowing them, because I think it takes off some of the load. But like I said, some you viewers here might say, no, Judy, you're totally wrong.
Well, I think when it comes to syllables and vowel flexing, we don't have enough research comparing the two strategies with each other,
right,
to say that this one is superior than the other one. A lot of theory, but we don't have that meta-analysis that we can go to say this one, you know, outperforms this one overall. And I think it, at this point in our understanding of, you know, the science of reading and teaching reading, right, where we're at today in June 6, 2022, we can't say that this one is superior over the other one. And in that instance, I think it's best to go with the teacher's comfort. So if you are syllables and you understand syllables and you can explain it to your student in syllables and they get syllables, then keep doing syllables.
Right.
And I think the important thing that we see is consistency across the school, as opposed to one year they get flexing sound, flexing the vowels, right, and the next year it's syllables and they're back to flexing. Right. It's where that continuity of instruction and having a scope and sequence across the school is really important.
I think so too. But I am open-minded enough that I am curious to learn, because like I said, my data for marking is pretty good, but there are some learners that are still struggling, and that's why I'm not gonna stop my journey. And the other thing you said is very interesting, that there's not enough science. I didn't actually know that. The thing with science is, though, somebody will always find one article like saying one thing, and sometimes there's another article. So like, I think that's important to keep in mind also. Like, I think the fact that everybody in general in the literacy world is looking at research is really important. But I think we have to stop being fearful also, because there is going to be another study that might, you know, look a little bit different. And sometimes there's multiple studies on thing. And that's one thing that I would love to one day talk to you about a little bit also. How do you navigate through all these studies and figure out what's the right approach? I think what you mentioned, Dr. Garforth, is very interesting. It's sometimes what you said, if you know a certain method really well and you see that it's working for your students and school-wide it's working well, you know, stay consistent with it. That doesn't mean you're not open-minded, but you also don't want to confuse your learners with doing 7 million different things and then systematically, you know, the ship breaks.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's where, so meta-analyses are where they take a look at all of the research and try and synthesize it and look at, based on what all of these studies in this area has said about this teaching practice. Now that's going to even out those oddball studies or the ones that have really good results or really poor results,
right,
and look at the ones that are really scientifically stringent versus the ones that are pretty lax and are more opinion or more qualitative research, right?
Interesting. I definitely would love to explore that a little bit more, because it is hard, because like, people will post something and then the next day somebody else is posting something that disputes it. And for regular teachers, I'm not a researcher, I'm a clinician, I'm a teacher to the core of my soul. It's very, very overwhelming, because what ends up happening is like, you're like, okay, it's working well, but is this the best? And it's like, it almost makes you feel like it's never enough. Like, I don't even know how to phrase it, but yeah, it is really overwhelming, especially right now in the literacy world. The second one article comes out, there's another side posting a counter argument, and then somebody else is quoting another piece of research, and it's like, oh, like, it's hard.
Well, that's where I personally like the work of Nathaniel Hansford from Pedagogy Non Grata. I've featured him several times on this podcast and webcast. Actually, on Wednesday, he's coming on and we're looking at his meta-analyses on phonemic awareness and phonological awareness instruction. So he's gone and taken a look at all of the studies, and he's going to tell us what these findings are. We've already spoken about phonics, vocabulary, comprehension, and fluency. So this week we're talking about phonological awareness, and next week we're talking about that morphological awareness and seeing what the research says, because that's what we want to inform our instruction. It takes too long to do those self-studies, right? You don't want to have to do trial and error year after year, right, as a teacher. You want to, and that's, I think, where we're kind of in the trap. Oh, well, I've done this, and based on my teacher programming, I learned this, and it's working for most of my kids, so I'm okay with it, because there's some that aren't going to get it. We know that there's dyslexia, right? But if we look at what the research says, and actually, well, it's pretty consistent that we can get about 95% of our kids reading by the end of primary school.
Right.
Well, we need to make sure our instruction's at that level, and if it's not, doing what we can to get it there.
Well, definitely, I'm not seeing every kid come out a reader lately, and it's really breaking my heart. Mm-hmm. So the urgency is there, you know?
Yeah.
There's kids going into third grade, and I've seen eighth graders, they can't read. Mm-hmm. That's a problem.
Yeah.
That's a huge problem. And life's not easy, we know that. And if you can't read, life's gonna be even harder, and it doesn't have to be that way. It's not equitable, it's not fair. And we can't ignore it. And principals cannot ignore it. Teachers can't ignore it. Parents can't ignore it. We have to do better. And
definitely.
I have a, yep. Can I just share something that I'm,
oh, sure.
That I love?
Yeah.
So this is Foundations makes this little flip chart.
Mm-hmm.
And I purchased it in one of my schools for all of my teachers. I think it's a game changer to have on your desk when you're doing small group instruction, because it helps the kids transfer those phonic skills and see that they're not just alive in phonics. So when you're doing your reading instruction, if the kids don't know how to draw a letter, there are the little visual cues. If they still need some drills in the letter sounds and the alphabet, you could quickly do a drill, or you can refer back to a certain letter and a sound that it makes while you're doing small group instruction with an actual book. You could review your vowels if needed and the sounds that they make, and it's on your desk as a visual reference tool, and it matches the instruction. And you don't have to use Foundations to use it, because it's just a really great little tool. And it also has marking of the words, the syllable types, and here, silent E, how vowels work. So having it accessible, having it everywhere, the brain loves repetition. I love repetition. I repeat a lot of the things I say because I feel they're important, and the brain wants to see a lot of the things that are important to them while they're learning. So love this little Foundation flip chart. You don't have to purchase the whole program. It's a la carte on Wilson, and I love it. It's been really helpful. And when I come into a classroom and I see that my teachers are using it, it's not because they want to make me happy, although I hope that they want to make me happy. It's because they know that transference has been the biggest piece of difficulty. Kids will know something in phonics time, but then not be applying it into books. And this is really super, super helpful.
Well, and that's why it's important that when you are doing that teaching, especially in the early grades, they're not completely distinct lessons. So when I'm doing a phonics lesson, you want to pair it with your reading lessons, right? And that's where the importance of decodable books comes in, because you're using a text that's paired with your scope and sequence so that they have the skills to sound out or decode 80 to 95% of the words in that text. So you're reinforcing that individual phonics lesson that you taught earlier in the day and say, oh, look, we can use this. Let's do it together. And
That's right.
The kids that need that explicit connection built for them, bridging phonics lesson to spelling lesson to reading a book, it's there for them. And it only takes that little bit of extra time.
Yeah. And I think that's what's been hard for a lot of us. I don't know out there in Canada, but for a lot of our educators in New York City in this part of the woods, some schools are starting to have more decodable texts. Some schools are moving into the science of reading. However, the books that they have are only level texts in there. So that's very confusing. So hopefully, as you know, we're shifting more towards the science of reading, we'll start seeing more of the materials that match the message that we're starting to, you know, send out there.
Mm-hmm.
Do I use only decodable text in my classroom? I don't. In beginning levels, is it very helpful for a lot of kids, especially in those beginning stages? It absolutely is. It absolutely is. It cuts out a lot of the guessing work. Kids know that their go-to strategy, you just taught a CVC word, you're working on a book with a lot of CVC words, boom, you're sliding through those words. It just makes the process easier for a lot of those kids. And I'm not a proponent. Some people like decodables only until they break the whole reading process. I'm a little bit more flexible in later stages where, you know, I know kids like a good story also once they've, you know, mastered a lot of those basic skills. But the point is that, you know, we can't say that we're shifting towards the science of reading and some teachers don't have one decodable in the classroom. Just know, guys, there are decodables available online. I was lucky enough. Yes, free. And we should probably make lists of where to get them free. I think there are a lot of free ones listed on the Florida Learning website, University of Florida. I think it's called USFI. By the way, yes. And they just came out with a new resource too. I just purchased their new manual. It's a new structured approach to literacy manual. Pre-orders just went in. But there's a lot of great decodables there. I was lucky enough to get trained in Orton Gillingham right now. So I have access to decodables that they gave me with my learning. They gave me a scope and sequence to follow and so forth. But just don't be afraid. Like if your boss is asking you to move into this and you can't find decodable text, those are the conversations to start having. You know, don't be afraid to say, I don't have the materials. Can you help me find them?
And if you are watching this as a replay or currently watching it live, know that in the show notes, we will make sure to have links to resources that we've mentioned in this conversation so that you can access them for further knowledge. Thank you so much for joining me today, Judy. Let's just do a quick review of those tips that you spoke about. So the first one was the syllables.
The first one, key one, learn your syllable types. If you don't know them, reach out to me, Judy, at the Literacy View, or read A Fresh Look on Phonics by Wiley Blevins. He beautifully summarizes it very beautifully quickly. Fun read too. Yeah. Number two, learn about those Elkhonon boxes. Start with those little chips, but don't stay in the chip phase for too long where you're pushing the sounds. Transition to getting that phonics piece in there where you start writing the letters, and then push yourself and your student next to spelling boxes because they have to know how those vowel teams work. They have to know that there's a silent E. So if you did the word like, you're going to have four boxes and you're going to start having those discussions about silent E. Next one was prompting students when they're looking at visual print and being specific when you prompt. You're going to prompt by saying, instead of saying, do you see a part that you know, you're going to say, do you see a glued sound that could help you? Or do you see a vowel team that you know? You know that vowel team says E. You might need to raise the level of support, or boom, it might click. The kid's like, oh yeah, I've seen that vowel team. The word is steam, boom. Also positive praise on specific behaviors. Don't just say good job, give specific praise. I really like the way you slid through that word, or I like how you noticed that vowel team in that word and you said, shh. All right, that was one of them. And then it wasn't really a tip, but like I said, I love my little foundations chart. Really helpful. And in a future episode, there's two more things that I want to share, but not today. I wanted to talk a little bit about that trick words should be renamed. They're not tricky. Some people are starting to call them heart words, and we could talk about that in another episode because not everything's tricky in a word like here. Yeah. Right? Some parts are decodable. And then the other thing was I wanted to maybe show the power of cut-ups and how you can take a sentence and cut it up strategically to help kids. If you're working on suffixes, you could cut a suffix in a word and then you put a sentence back together and boom, you're targeting the skill of reading, rereading, phrasing and fluency, and all that good stuff. So hopefully you and I will have time to talk once again in the near future.
For sure. Thank you so much.